I have good news. Unexpected, but the Earth has incredibly powerful regenerative systems that we have barely begun to understand and support. This is partially because we are only now broadly coming to understand them, partially because of ingrained existing practices, and largely from perverse political and economic incentives, be it what it may. There are many regenerative systems like this, and most of them are dwarfed any current technological innovation on the horizon. They inherently meet the scale of our problem because they are the scale of our problem when embraced holistically. They are quite literally the size of the Earth. The good news is there are untapped systems that align with our goals for decarbonization, planet cooling, food security, and so much more. There is one specifically that covers all of these. It alone, when supported in a healthy way, can take as much carbon out of the air annually as we emit annually as a species. It can be our net zero. It is soil, it is alive, and it changed my life. More on that later. It is something that everyone on Earth can work on today. It is also something that can greatly benefit from things like artificial intelligence, machine learning, and so much more. It is the best solution that I have found that can make change holistically and measurably. It sequesters gigatons of carbon while optimizing nutritional yield and delivers equity and provides prosperity. And about 15 other impact categories that I don't have time to cover here today. This is why I love teaching people the value of soil versus dirt. When transitioning into the climate court some time ago, I became fascinated with regenerative processes where the Earth can replenish, regrow, and heal itself. I also became fascinated with the concept of biomimicry, at its core, embracing natural systems to guide our design and innovation, but specifically how biomimicry can be leveraged to use ecological processes to design systems and facilitate systems change. But usually, before you arrive at biomimicry, you ask yourself one simple question. Does the Earth have a solution to the thing you perceive to be a problem? Now, let's be clear. The Earth may not perceive it as a problem, but there may be a solution within nature's technology that solves your problem. If yes, then before rushing to innovation or concrete or ego, look to biomimicry. How would nature solve this? And can we or are we supporting those systems to the best of our ability? Some were not. And yes, I did say nature's technology. Natural systems are inherently technology. And again, I have good news. I know you didn't expect good news to be the theme of this talk today, but spoiler alert, it gets better. When many people think of technology in the hallowed ground of our institutions or in the innovation hub of Silicon Valley, they often think of human-driven tech development. In these cases, the time to develop the technology and the QA that follows are often the most expensive elements, not to mention coming up with the IP and the ideas in the first place. Well, when looking to nature's technology and biomimicry, the QA has been completed over millennia, fine-tuned, thousands of years of engineering effort. The data sets, the proof, it's already there, ready to be processed. It always has been. So, back to soil. What do we know? Soil is the second largest carbon sink on the planet, behind the ocean, ready to reclaim its role in biosequestration at scale. And it bears note that healthy soil practices also support ocean health. Now, the soil-to-ocean relationship deserves a talk dedicated on its own, so more on that another time. When focusing on agriculture, if we convert monoculture tilled land to low-till, no-till regenerative practices, that land alone can take as much carbon out of the air annually as we emit annually, as I said previously. However, let's not lean on that detail to get to net zero. Why? Because soil is in a unique position to be the greatest partner that we have to achieve drawdown. You know that legacy load of carbon that we've had in the atmosphere thus far? It's still up there, needs to come down. We need a partner in that. But what else is happening alongside this carbon sequestration, or rather biosequestration, to be more specific? Well, healthy carbon-rich soil means healthy microbes, which we now know directly relate to enhanced nutrition. Here's a fun fact. There's now a handheld spectrometer being tested, usually a big expensive machine that only exists in a lab or university. This spectrometer can fit in your pocket and measure nutrient density. You can take it to a supermarket, hold it up to one carrot versus the next. Both may be organic, and one may have 90 times more nutrients than the other. This directly ties back to the microbial environment in which it grew, the soil. So along the way to carbon sequestration at scale, you get food security and resilience and equity and so much more. These regenerative practices also expand the soil so it can hold more water, fending off both droughts and floods. Yes, there's more. When you're not tilling the land, you're protecting it with cover crops. This cools the ground, it supports transpiration and additional ecosystems and pollinators and more. If we make these things a priority, This all can happen relatively quickly, but of course, it will take effort. But in the context of what is at risk, that effort is minimal. Now, it bears note, these practices that I'm talking about here today are not new for humanity. Indigenous people globally have been practicing them for thousands of years. For generations, these communities have been asking for other people to pay attention, to listen to the lessons the Earth has for us. Alas, this is a whole other conversation that needs to be had more broadly on its own in the context of reconciliation and system change. And yet, this brings me to the most powerful part of soil as a primary climate solution, its intersectionality. As discussed, soil-related opportunities touch upon so many communities and interests, it may be our greatest unifier available. We can embrace multidisciplinary approach needed to achieve climate change at scale. With soil, independently or together, we can work toward the intersectionality of social, racial, environmental justice. We can clearly see the confluence of art, science, technology, and policy. We can remove the myth of externalities by embracing traditional capital and natural capital holistically, especially when considering that nature-based markets are $7 trillion a year. With soil and other solutions, we can achieve drawdown. For this, there is an actionable plan. Given the scale of the challenge and the democratized and distributed nature of the solution, we need to activate, educate, and engage at scale. We need regional centers to support municipalities and populations as uniquely needed for their bioregion and watershed, to train people, to support communities, to provide resilience. We are in a climate crisis. And pragmatically, all crises require first responders, distributed with information, resources, and technology, led by local populations in alignment with their ecosystems. And again, I have good news. This is not rocket science, but a little rocket science could probably help. Soil is indeed a big tent, with benefits for all climate and ecological mindsets, from increasing the health and prosperity of rural communities, to waste stream capture and closed-loop systems, from workforce development to early childhood brain development. So, what to do? You can support legislation that centers on natural systems. You can help transition harmful practices. You can steer your municipality to build soil and improve water systems. You can start an urban farm, a food forest, or a soil science center. You can build AI that enhances soil biodiversity and so much more. Or maybe you're in sustainable finance, seeking globally scalable net new ESG projects with measurable carbon, biodiversity, and nutrition impacts. Remember how I said soil can change my life? Well, when I learned these things, I pivoted my entire life to help co-found the REAP Climate Center. And we've already touched the lives of thousands of people. We're working towards all of these things that I spoke about here today. And whenever possible, we lead with curiosity and playfulness. We're focused on soil science, regenerative systems, with an overarching goal to onboard people into climate engagements. Our half-mile-long campus on an island in the middle of the San Francisco Bay hopes to be a template for many more centers to come globally to deploy these solutions. Our plan to scale meets the scale of the challenges at hand. And speaking of hands, we could certainly use a few. Because we have to get this right before replicating the model, and the clock is ticking. So please, join our growing list of partners, volunteers, and members wherever you are, or start a center in your area. There is no real reason we cannot accelerate these solutions today, starting with soil, all soil, everywhere. Thank you.